Clemmer. Phil, come on out. You know as Norgard, Courtney Ford. Zari, Tala Ash. Heatwave, Dominic Purcell. The White Canary, Sarah Lance. Constantine, Matt Ryan, Ava Sharp, Jess McCallan, and executive producer, Kenno Shimizu. Ladies and gentlemen, your Legends of Tomorrow. All right, Phil, I'm gonna put this first one right to you. This is a show with an enormous cast that you had revolve a little bit.
Yeah.
What's it like, you know, planning for that and dealing with that and watching the cast grow and shift and change as we go from season to season?
Yeah, we had this moment this year where we realized that of the original nine people who were on the rooftop in the pilot, that only three of them remain here. And, you know, every year the infusion, like when we brought on Maisie and we brought on Nick in season two, and then again when we brought on Courtney and Tala, and
Jess.
Yes, I'm here.
It's just so far down there. You know, it's, you know, for us, it's like having more toys in the toy box, and it takes the existing dynamics on the ship.
That's what we are.
Just toys to you?
Living action figures. It's a show. If you normally write a show, you get tired of people's voices because the dynamics are just, you know, one direction. But with this number of people and new people, like for us, every scene effectively feels like a new scene because, you know, there are times in where we're like, these people have never been in a scene together, and that's super exciting.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I mean, is it possible to add more to this cast?
It is possible. Yeah, we have a couple people.
On a bigger table.
Yeah, we're gonna need like stack seating. But we're bringing on a performer named Ramona Young, who's going to be playing a new person who works at the Time Bureau. We're kind of expanding the world of the Bureau now that Ava and Sarah are so romantically connected. And she's going to start out. She's going to start out as a person who works at Postmates and brings sandwiches to Gary, and gradually we'll find a way to sort of you know, include her in our world of magical beasts and fantastical monsters and, you know, the world that we're going to live in this season. And then Kenno can help introduce another exciting new cast.
Yes. In terms of, you know, building out the world of the Time Bureau, we're also going to be, you know, having characters shift in a different direction, like Nate, will be living a little bit more in the real world, where he has sort of had a sabbatical from for the last couple of years. And he'll be reconnecting with a father who he's been estranged from during that time, and also has had a very distant relationship throughout his childhood and young adulthood. And the man that we're having come play this pivotal role for this season is no stranger to time travel.
Who is he? Tell us who it is.
he and his son have a contentious relationship, so much so that he might tell Nate he needs to make like a tree and get out of here. And for Back to the Future fans, Tom Wilson, aka Biff Tannen.
Dominic, how upset are you that Matt's ruined your Aruba vacation?
My what?
The Aruba vacation?
when he bought the dragon.
Oh, that's it. Yes, I was very upset.
But we already ruined it by joining
that's
the
right.
vacation.
Sorry, I was somewhere else.
Matt, joining a show like this with a character that you've been for a couple of years now has got to be an amazing feeling for you. Can you tell us a little bit about what it's like now coming onto the set and getting into it?
Yeah,
it's great. Now look, it was 4 years ago today
that I was sitting here when Constantine first was on NBC and...
Yeah!
And, you know, I've got to play this character now in the Arrowverse on Arrow and then, you know, coming on to Legends and then the various iterations in the animation world and now I'm back 4 years later and...
Who are you anticipating butting heads with the most?
Hello, mate. what's great is like everything that I've studied about this character I've learned from the comic books, and all the different characters that he interacts with are from the comic books. And what we have here is a bunch of characters that Constantine has never interacted with before. So it's something new for me to discover in this part of the journey with the character. How all those dynamics work with all these guys, you know? I think that Mick is someone we would butt heads with quite a lot. But then again, you know, he provides a flame for Constantine's terrible habit, so maybe they might go somewhere along the line.
Never mind.
Katie, I've got to ask, you've been able to grow with this character and become the team's basically fearless leader.
Yeah.
This show means a lot to a lot of people, and I think, you know, a lot of people would like to relate to your character. What's it been like for you now to get to this point, and what are you excited to see move further?
Well, this show actually means a lot to all of us, too, so we're glad that you guys really like it. I think sometimes I forget when I'm thinking about Sarah, it's like, oh, she's like a female leader. But not only is she a female leader, she's like in a bisexual LGBTQ character that's a leader.
Mm-hmm.
And it's really awesome, you know, that the writers have created a character like that and is putting that representation on TV because it really does matter. And Sarah's journey has just been an interesting, crazy one. It's just thing after thing. And the writers keep surprising me on where they can go through next because I'm like, how do you, she's been through it all, she's seen it all, and yet they're still always delivering.
Are you excited to sort of take the action up a notch? I know a lot of fans get a real kick out of seeing a lot of your workout stuff and your practice fighting. Are you ready to kick it up a notch?
Yeah, we were talking about this, how we can dedicate a little bit more time to some of the fight scenes so we can really execute some crazy stuff. And we just did some wire work stunt rehearsals for episode 2, so there should be some cool stunts coming.
Yes. Courtney, last season was a pretty crazy one for Nora.
It was.
So now that, you know, as we head into season 4, what mindset, you know, is Nora in, and what are you looking forward to bring to the table now?
Well, Nora, I really feel for her because she's been through a lot. You know, both her parents were killed, she was put into foster care, then she was in a mental institution, and she was basically possessed by a demon from 13 to into her 30s. You know,
yeah,
so,
normal child.
You know.
Right. Normal stuff.
How it is. Yeah, so now she's not with Mollus, she's not with her father, and she has to figure out who she is without these influences. You know, is she going to continue down the dark path, or is she, you know, going to get a job at Starbucks? I don't know. you know, will she become kind of a complicated ally? I don't know.
She's going to see a ray of light.
Oh,
well, let's talk about that a little
but
bit.
But yeah, his Ray is such a ray of light, yes. such a positive energy and such an incredibly positive influence. You know, is she going to be more drawn towards that or go there?
Brandon, what's your perspective on that? I mean, are we about to see a new ship set sail?
Well, I mean, it's possible that it already has set sail. I think it's up to both characters to figure out. Talking about earlier.
Set sail.
Now we're mixing our metaphors all over the place. I think it's up to both of them kind of what it becomes. They've had some crazy experiences already together, trying to kill each other and possibly doing it and saving each other. And so is their bond because of that, or is their bond because there's something real there? Are they just friends and together because they're such opposites and they're learning from each other? Or is there something else there? So I think it's, we're definitely going to explore all of those possibilities, I think.
Nice. Phil, I gotta address the giant, fluffy, blue... success and popularity for Bebo.
Yeah, wow.
Right? Is that something you guys ever anticipated?
Not really. I mean, I think when we first came up with the idea, it was really kind of a joke. It was, yeah. You know, the premise of that episode was like, okay, well, what if a Tickle Me Elmo essentially landed in Viking times and, became...
They fell in love, obviously, a little avalanche there. I think these two really strong women try to domesticate, whatever that means, find time for each other and, you know, slow down and be softer. And we're going to see a softer side of Miss Lance for sure. Very, very softer side of Ava as well. Very, very soft side.
Yeah.
Tal, I gotta ask, you posted a picture of you and Brandon on Instagram last week in 60s garb, which we saw a little bit in the footage. What can you tell us a little bit about that?
I think the first episode is gonna be really exciting. It's everything but the kitchen sink to start, so I can't imagine where we're going. But yeah, we are in the 60s. We'll be in Woodstock. I think I can say that. Yeah, we're gonna be in Woodstock, and we might cross paths with the Beatles also in the 60s. I'm so excited for you guys to see the first episode. It's just so crazy. It's gonna be great.
Now, Nick, since we had a bit of news earlier in the panel with you potentially butting heads with your dad, what are you you looking forward to that?
Yeah, Nick started off as a real life person who became a superhero, so it's nice that we get to go back to the person and the origins of Nick, which Tom, he's phenomenal, and it's great to play around with him as Nate's dad. You get a lot of insight to Nate's history, and I get to find out like really cool behind the scenes Back to the Future stuff.
Adam, Gary Green has sort of been a bit of a fan favorite.
Wow.
What's it like getting all that extra attention?
Rare. Not normal, very exciting though. Thank you everyone for liking Gary.
What can we expect from Gary Green this year?
He will continue to listen to his boss diligently and follow through on every mission with perfection like he always does.
With that, let's get to some fan questions. There we go.
Thank you for the bisexual representation. You guys delivered in spades. I'm so happy. Thank you. And then my question is, do you know anything about New Legends merchandise? And if you don't, what merchandise would you like to see from the show?
Where is the Legends merchandise?
I buy mine from fans. I kid you not, I have to buy it from fans because much, and I like to wear it. I like to show off my show that I'm very proud of, and there's great stuff online. But I wish there could be some more official merchandise. WWE.
I mean, that's a gold mine sitting next to you. Yeah, that's great.
I know, right? Like this guy.
Yeah, where'd you get the Bebos? You see?
See?
Wow.
Yeah. Oh my God.
There is a crazy, enormous Etsy market.
I'm gonna order one tomorrow.
Yes, Etsy is amazing.
Yep. All right, next question.
Yeah, I'm Trey, and I was gonna ask if we're gonna see Firestorm or Snart in the future season.
We're gonna start a second riser.
I'm sorry. Yeah, I wish we had good news to announce on that front, but at the moment we don't. But we certainly keep that in our back pocket, and you know, there's a lot of seasons to come, hopefully. So we'll see.
Anything's possible with
you. Anything's possible.
I mean, yeah. How many times have I died?
Yeah.
Anybody
can
go back.
Seriously, who knows? We can count.
Next question.
Hey guys. My name is Jalal. This question is for Tala. There's a lot of female empowerment on the show, and of course, you can continue to shatter stereotypes. But of course, you know, being an immigrant and being a Muslim, what do you love most about being Zara, you know, playing a character?
I love her for a lot of reasons, but personally, as an actor, I take the issue of representation really seriously for myself. And I and with the writers and with the showrunners have worked really hard to have this character be, yes, she's the first Muslim American superhero on television, which is dope. She's a hacker, she's a very sarcastic person, it's a part of her identity, and I think it's played into the show in what I hope is an organic way, and I think it's really important to all of us to, and we're going to see some of that, we're going to see some of her backstory actually this year, to understand where she comes from, and she's experienced prejudice in a very real way in the future, and she kind of sees the worst version of some of the xenophobia that's happening right now in our country and in the world play out in a really terrible way. So she kind of has hindsight in a way, and she's trying to, I think, pass that on to the other legends and also apply it to what's going on, but I'm really proud to play her and to represent this character in a way that, you know, it's not always what we see on television. Thanks for the question.
All right, next question.
Hi, my name is Connor, I want to ask, it's for the whole cast. Will the survival of Zambezi impact the Arrowverse timeline?
Whoa.
Damn, Tom.
I was hoping we'd get that. Well, in a way, it already has, just in terms of where we saw Kuasa Jiwei in the finale. Having, you know, established that she and her sister Mari, you know, share the totem and are protecting, you know, Detroit together. So yeah, in that way, at least in the larger Arrowverse that has, you know, lived in the animated series, would be impacted. Things are better over there, which is nice to see.
Next question.
Hi, my name is Natalie, and my question is for Katie. Sarah is one of my favorite characters ever on TV. She's a woman who's strong, she's a great fighter, she's tough, but she's also very strong, she's strategic, and she makes a lot of tough decisions, and she's a great leader. So my question is, how much of you do you see in her, and how much of her do you see in you?
Oh, I mean, you just said so many nice things. I mean, ever since I was little, I think I kind of had I want to do things my way. I like to be in charge. So in that sense, we have that in common. I think Sarah's way tougher than I am. I always think like someone's gonna like try to fight me on the street because they're like, oh, you're so bad butt, like. She's much tougher than me in real life, but there's a lot of similarities. I think actually a lot of our characters are very similar to all of us. Thank you for your kind words.
All right, next question.
Hi, my name is Austin. I've watched Legends in Season 1, and this question is for my favorite legend and rogue, Mick Rory. Is Mick still trying to fill the void that Star left after he died? Is he looking for a partner still?
Oh, here we go.
Whoa.
You know, Mick was an abused kid, and I think with any tough guy, there's always a defense mechanism, any man in particular, starts overtly, you know, overpronouncing their machismo, if you will, or hiding something, so deep down, there's a lot of torture, scars, and Mick is very much like that. He's very, very dark, but at the same time, he is, as I was speaking to Phil this morning, you know, he's a sweetheart, deep down. And this is his It's
sounds
drawing.
Like real life.
Yeah. So, no, but he does yearn for. I'm going to call him Captain Cole. I mean, that's who he is to me. You know, he yearns for Captain Cole. Cole's his true friend, and he always looked up to Captain Cole. And besides, I, you know, one of my best friends in the world went with Miller.
I think it's sometimes really hard to bring things that happen onto other shows onto your show. It's very difficult. And everything creates this butterfly effect. And our show is also a comedy now, and it's light and it's fun, and your dad dying isn't always like, you know, it's also fun. That kind of takes place, Sarah dealing with that takes place before the season starts. We talk about it a little bit, but you don't really see it. Though I think there's a lot of opportunity with Black Siren to happen, whether it's me going on to Arrow or Katie Cassidy coming over. I think if we all push hard enough for that to happen, I think the powers that be might make it happen.
Hashtag starts right now. Next question.
Hi, my name is Gavin. And if you guys could be any other superhero, which one would you be?
Generous with their characters, and yeah, I will tell them you asked, I promise. But I cannot break any more children's hearts.
All right, next question.
Hi guys, I'm Jeff. My question's for Matt specifically. Are we gonna see any angels come visit Constantine, kind of like Manny?
Well, I think wherever John goes, he always takes his bag of tricks, his baggage, his personal baggage with him, and there's always a devil waiting on his shoulder and an angel waiting on his shoulder as well, so who knows?
All right, next question.
Hi, my name is Kale, and in the latest season, you took Heather and Troy to Themyscira, so I was wondering if Wonder Woman would make her way into the show.
Yeah. We would.
That would be great. Yeah, that would be amazing. Is Gal Gadot available?
You gotta see Gal Gadot after.
Chris is a big fan of the show, so you know.
I think we're lucky we got the word Themyscira in the show. We'll take anything else they want to give us.
Awesome. Next question.
She's a big fan.
Hi, my name is Jake, and I was just wondering, will we see any more adventures between Gary and Constantine?
Is it a constant Gary?
A constant green.
I prefer Greenstantine, but no one listens to me. Let's go to that. Sure, you know, I think they get on well, don't they? There's a really good dynamic between the two characters, and they riff off each other, and, you know, John, being who John is, will use anyone to his advantage, so, sure. Gary loves following John around and helping him any way he can.
All right, last question.
Hi, my name is Sydney, and I have a question for the whole cast. What do you guys like doing when you're, like, not on the show? Like, your pastimes?
Oh. Yeah. You guys have a life?
Shop? Already created. There you go. So we just created a website called Chic Already. So behind the scenes, one of the wonderful things about being up in Vancouver together is a bunch of us women across the show have been writing articles for it. We want you guys to submit your articles as well, and it's going to continue to grow, so just give us your feedback and check it out.
I like playing dad. I just like being my kid.
Yeah.
Like that's like work and throwing a baby in the air.
That's my answer too, for the most part. And let's take the books on tape.
He really does listen to the books on tape, and he comes in and tells me about it.
Download it. Upload it to you?
Dom likes to serve.
Yeah, so I think that's good.
I like to play.
And my children.
You do your
I like art, painting, crafting. I always have something on that. Yeah.
Cal plays like 11 instruments.
I do play some instruments.
Do you?
Yeah. You do.
Nice. Well, with that, ladies and gentlemen, give it up one more time.